Alright, cool. To everyone at Ashley University, Professor Hanover. Lucky enough, I was able to have three Saga students sacrifice their lunches and let me teach them this lesson about Pearl Harbor here. We have Nicole, Kira, and Gabby's a film student, or in the film class here at Saga, helping me film this. So we're going to talk about Pearl Harbor and the build-up to war today. Alright, so we're going to start out by asking you guys, alright, so what do you know about Pearl Harbor and the lead-up in the United States entering World War II, kind of the lead-up, or just kind of any general knowledge about it? All right, Nicole?
It happened December 7th, 1941.
That's very good. That is the date that it happened. Kira?
I know thousands of Navy soldiers lost their lives that day.
Oh, yeah. Well, a little over 2,000. All right, Gabby?
I'm a little unfamiliar with Pearl Harbor, more towards the World War II in Germany rather than in Pearl Harbor, so a little unfamiliar.
Oh, perfect. So we're going to kind of get into all this right now. So Pearl Harbor, it really is kind of like not only the most important moment in American history in the 20th century, it's one of the most important moments in the history of the whole United States because it's what brought us into war. World War II, which was the most bloody conflict in the history of the world, more people dead than any other conflict of all time. And so today that's what we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about how the U.S. got into war and why the December 7, 1941 is so important. And we're also going to talk about a little bit about the background of Europe, kind of the rise of fascism, post-World War I, and we're also going to talk about the background of Asia, how kind of Japan, the Japan Empire, how they went into China, and eventually went into Southeast Asia. All right? So right now, we're going to watch a little 3-minute clip, and right here that's going to be that's the Japanese Imperial War flag. Not supposed to happen.
It usually spent the weekends in port.
So this is the attack.
In total radio silence, the Japanese strike force gathered in Tankan Bay in the northerly Kuril Islands. Fleet set sail on November the 26th, 1941. Meanwhile, as a decoy, Japanese negotiators arrived in Washington to discuss a possible Japanese withdrawal from China. The Japanese fleet refueled after several days at sea. 3 days later, it was off Hawaii. The Americans were still blissfully unaware that anything was wrong. At 6 a.m. on December the 7th, after the final briefing, the first wave of Japanese aircraft took off. Into the attack, U.S. personnel were still just stirring on a fine Sunday morning. It was all over in less than 2.25 hours. Yamamoto's plan had worked like a dream. Or had it? There was only one problem. The U.S. fleet's two aircraft carriers had not been in Pearl Harbor at the time and had escaped the attack. Yamamoto's main aim of crippling the U.S. Pacific fleet had only partially succeeded. U.S. naval air power in the region was still intact. But in the United States, there was shock and disbelief. turned into a mood of fury and determination. Angry mobs attacked the Japanese embassy. Japan had disturbed a sleeping giant. The U.S. Secretary of the Navy, Frank Knox, spoke for many.
The Japs started this war. We are going to finish it.
Yet before the U.S. could mobilize its full strength, the Japanese were to inflict more humiliating defeats on the Western Allies.
Alright, cool. So yeah, that was our video clip, kind of just getting you guys started, kind of this general overview of Pearl Harbor. We're going to kind of start, go back about 20 years before Pearl Harbor happened. So we're going to start out, it's kind of post-World War I, Europe is in complete ruins, and at the time it was the bloodiest, you know, conflict of all time. You have 41 million total dead, 41 million total casualty, 18 million dead, and there's a flu epidemic was responsible for one third of the total deaths responsible in World War I. All right, so after World War I, Europe's in ruins, and kind of what happens in the war is that people are looking to place blame. Like, and so in terms of this war, since you know the French, the British, and the Americans, they basically won World War I, the British and the French, they wanted, you know, repayment. So they placed the blame on the Germans for World War I. So 1919, the Paris Peace Conference established the League of Nations, kind of the precursor of the United Nations. And it was the whole point of it was kind of stop these great conflicts from happening. However, one of the things that happened from, what do you call it, the League of Nations is the Treaty of Versailles, and it placed blame on war for Germany and resulted in Germany losing territory in a severe economic depression in Germany, because at the time they wanted them to pay about $5 billion to each nation reparations. Now in 1919, $5 billion is the equivalent of $600 billion today. So imagine if, you know, we had to pay $600 billion to, you know, a country for war, we're gonna go into depression. And so it was also criticized for being too lenient, because what it did do, it did not get rid of Germany's military. It allowed them to keep 100,000 units. So it allowed them to still, you know, have a military, but at the same time, they had to pay, you know, the giant fee. So it kind of sent Germany into a severe depression after World War I because of the Treaty of Versailles. All right, and so this is kind of more background to Europe. So at the end of the World War I, also you have the rise of communism in Russia. So the Russian Revolution, subsequent Russian Civil War, led to the overthrow of the Romanov monarchy in Russia and the spread of communism and the establishment of the Soviet Union. So this kind of happens right during this time, 1919-1920, and it's led by Vladimir Lenin, who eventually Joseph Stalin would take over. So Germany, as a result of the Treaty of Versailles and the weak Weimar Republic that kind of took over Germany after World War I, was in a dire state economically and socially. And they were, so Germany throughout the whole 1920s was in a severe economic depression, where the inflation was so bad that people were actually putting like German marks on the walls for wallpaper, because wallpaper was too expensive. So they used actual money for wallpaper on restaurants and stuff like that. And also around this time, very important, Benito Mussolini rises to power in Italy, and ushers in a new era of fascist rule. And this is the first fascist ruler to really gain prominence in such a, like, you know, a powerful nation such as Italy. And that's kind of something that happened in the early 1920s and spread throughout Europe and eventually spread to Spain and Germany. All right, so we're going to talk about the rise of fascism in Europe now. All right, so Benito Mussolini came to power in 1920 and creates a fascist government that will rule Italy for a little over 20 years. In 1935, Italy invades Ethiopia and Africa in October of 1935. Now, the thing about the Ethiopian invasion is that it's kind of, Italy wanted to have colonial holdings, and so they chose kind of Ethiopia as an easy target because they were fully militaries, had, you know, fully automatic weapons, fully automatic guns, when a lot of Ethiopian, you know, infantry, they're armed with, you know, spears and bow and arrows, so hundreds of thousands of people died in that war. And one of the most interesting things about this, if you go down, Adolf Hitler in 1933, about 11 years later, is elected chancellor in Germany. He was democratically elected, and his Nazi party was democratically elected to the Reichstag in Germany. So it wasn't like they just came in and take over power. They were elected by the people, which is something very important to remember. And in 1934, he declares himself Führer, and he remilitarizes Germany. So not only does he have the 100,000 units, 100,000 troops that are allowed for the Treaty of Versailles, he starts making it more and more, starts re-pulling the army and reinstills national pride. A little bit after that, Spanish Civil War, Francisco Franco was the fascist in charge, and he was supported by Germany and Italy, and he ends up gaining power in about 1937 and installs his own fascist government. So during this time, this guy right here, this is British Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain. And he was worried about the territorial ambitions of these two men. You got Adolf Hitler, Benito Mussolini. Well, they're, well, especially Hitler, because he decided he took the Sudetenland of Slovakia, basically annexed it, and he basically, Germany took over Austria. Austria became part of Germany at this time. So Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain was really worried about this, British Prime Minister. And so his idea was to just pursue a policy of appeasement. And by appeasement means, like, we're going to let Germany have the Sudetenland, we're going to let them have Austria, just as soon as maybe we're going to appease them now so they don't go to war later. So they want to practice that, you know, think of appeasement, hoping that it would stop the Europe from pledging to war again. But however, in August 23rd, 1939, Germany and the Soviet Union, which is funny because fascism and communism are mortal enemies, they signed the Molotov-Ribbentrop Non-Aggression Pact, basically almost forming an alliance that they want to attack each other. And Neville Chamberlain thought that would stop war, not the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact, but a week later after the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact, Germany invades Poland, September 1st, 1939, and that starts World War II. So now we're going to go back to the Asia and the Pacific. So Emperor Hirohito comes to power in Japan in 1926, and he quickly wants to pursue more expansionist policies, because if you guys ever seen Japan on a map, or if you've been to Japan, it's a small island.
Would Logan DeShazer please come to the front office? Logan DeShazer to the front office, please.
Alright, so yeah, Japan's kind of a smaller island nation, and they're really expansionistic, and they want to go into, you know, Asia, get natural resources, have a greater empire. So in 1931, Japan invades Manchuria, which is a part of China. League of Nations strongly convinced Japanese invasion in China, and subsequently leaves the League of Nations in 1933, because one of the biggest weaknesses of the League of Nations is that all they can really do is condemn you. To get someone to force you to leave and get actually troops on the ground to make Japan leave China, you need a unanimous vote of all like 60 nations that are part of the League of Nations. So it's incredibly difficult to get really anything done. A kind of example is like our own Senate. We need a 60-vote supermajority just to get anything passed. We haven't gotten anything passed in years. They need everyone unanimous. So after that, Japan decides to leave the League of Nations. 1937, the Second Sino-Japanese War breaks out between China and Japan. This is where kind of the Rape of Nanking happened, and there's estimated during the Rape of Nanking in China that between 100,000 and 300,000 Chinese civilians, women, and children were massassacred during the Rape of Nanking in 1937. Now, kind of more towards the Western nations, the United States, Britain, France, and others have grown increasingly worried about Japanese imperialism as it threatened their colonial hold in Southeast Asia. The reason for that is because they pretty much hold all of Southeast Asia. Vietnam at this time, it's French. Kind of like Burma during this time, it's a British colony. Indonesia, it's a Dutch colony. So Japan's actually coming in from China. They're worried that Japan's going to come in and just start taking over all their colonial holdings. So this kind of gets Western powers like really worried about this. Now, okay, this right here, that's a picture of Emperor Hirohito of Japan. He actually lived till 1989. That's when he died. He was born in 1898, so lived, you know, pretty long life. So in an attempt to convince Japan to end its war with China, the United States passed a series of restrictive trade measures decided to limit Japan's access to valuable resources such as oil and scrap metal. Now, the U.S. was the main supplier of Japan for their scrap metal and their oil, which you really need, you know, to run, you know, a war. I mean, yeah. So, and this failed, however, because Japan actually signed a tripartite pact with Germany and Italy in 1940, officially forming the Axis powers. And in 1940, as you can see, the kind of the Western powers were Japan invades French Indochina, which is Vietnam. And the Western powers attempted to negotiate an end to Japanese hostilities in the West to no avail. They also did things like close off the Panama Canal zone so no Japanese ships could, you know, go through the Panama Canal. And the increasing amount of trade restrictions and sanctions put on Japan by the United States led to an increase in tension between the two nations. So we're going to kind of see, everything's kind of building up right now. All right, and so we're going to kind of go towards the United States really quick. So after World War I, the United States is, as compared to all of Europe, none of the fighting in World War I was taking place in the United States. You know, we're in a position of relative power throughout the whole world. Now, President Woodrow Wilson at the time, he created the League of Nations. However, he did not want to be part of the United Nations because the United States is very isolationist. We wanted everyone else to kind of deal with their own problems. Like, if Europe's going to fight a bloody war, a million people die, that's not our issue. That's kind of was the sentiment in the U.S. at the time. So during the 20s was a time of great economic prosperity in the United States. It was also known as the Roaring Twenties or the Jazz Age, time of Prohibition, same time. However, at the end of the 1920s, the stock market crashed, sending the world into a severe economic depression known as the Great Depression. So a little more background on the United States. So this is President Franklin Delano Roosevelt, one of the most important, one of the greatest presidents of all time. he was so popular he served 4 consecutive terms, which you're not allowed to do now because you can only serve 2 terms now. But he was that popular. So he's elected in 1932, very kind of guy, you know, for the people. He signs the New Deal, economic stimulus, wants to, you know, get people back to work, give Americans jobs, people who lost their jobs. And despite the, and you can look at this right here, despite the rise of fascism in Europe and the right through Japanese imperialism, even isolationists still in the U.S., such as Ambassador to Great Britain Joseph Kennedy, were worried of drawing another European conflict that can join, that can claim millions of lives. Let's talk about Joseph Kennedy really quick. His His one son was actually a fighter pilot in World War II and got shot down over Germany. One of his other sons was JFK. So JFK's dad actually was the ambassador to Great Britain during this time for Franklin Delano Roosevelt. And during this time, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, after Joseph Kennedy, almost not siding with Hitler, but just said he wants to reunite German-speaking lands and peoples, fired Joseph Kennedy. So Joseph Kennedy swore, basically, you know, revenge against the Roosevelts for the rest of his life, which is, you know, a pretty crazy tidbit of American history right there. So, and then Roosevelt, who was not an isolationist, grew increasingly worried about the growing threat of fascism in Europe and Japanese imperialism, moved the United States closer to war. All right, so this is right before Pearl Harbor, and despite not officially going to war, the United States passed a series of acts, sanctions, and bargaining with Japan to give aid to the Allied countries reducing passive access powers to conduct war. So the Lend-Lease Act was basically passed in 1941. It was for Britain, China, and the Soviet Union. So basically we give them weapons, materials, bases, stuff like that, totaling at about $50 billion. Most of that went to the British and the Soviet Union. So, and as a result, Japanese imperialists in the United States passed the trade embargoes, shut down the Panama Canal to the Japanese, and Roosevelt actually moved the Pacific Fleet to Pearl Harbor to show his strength of the Japanese Imperial Navy. All right, and as a result of the United States oil embargo, Japan realized that without U.S. oil, they'd be out of oil in 2 years. And this forced them to negotiate. Now, negotiations were kind of mostly like a facade because they were already planning the attack on Pearl Harbor. And so right here, and in November 1941, Emperor Hirohito finally approved the attack to be carried out in early December. All right, and so the attack on Pearl Harbor itself, the main goal was to destroy the U.S. fleet in the Pacific, basically so Japan could do whatever they wanted, you know, during this time. And on November 26, 1941, as we saw in the video, that's when the Japanese fleet left Japan and it started sailing towards northwest of Hawaii. And the attack was intended to be in 2 waves. All right, so right here, this is actually the USS Arizona Memorial. It's the name of all the people who died during Pearl Harbor. There, I've been there. Very beautiful place. Very, very patriotic, great place to be. And so December 7, 1941, like Nicole said, Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor. And the attack was not meant to be surprised, which is actually very interesting. Japanese officials were supposed to deliver a declaration of war 30 minutes before the attack. However, this is 1941 time, so it's hard sending even just a 5,000-word message across continents and stuff. So it took way too long, and as soon as they delivered the message to the Americans, the attack was already happening. So it was, in all intents and purposes, a surprise attack. And even a United States radar facility on Oahu detected a large fleet of aircraft approaching Pearl Harbor, but the lieutenant in charge thought it was just a fleet. The B-17 bombers arriving from California that morning. All right, so the attack happens. It's carried out in 2 waves of fighters and bombers. It's widely successful as the Pacific Fleet at Pearl Harbor was largely neutralized. He halted the third wave. All right, and during this battle, 2,400 Americans were killed, 1,100 were wounded, 4 battleships were sunk, 15 damaged. Although, the most important part about Pearl Harbor overall is that all the aircraft carriers were outside of Pearl Harbor on military exercises, which actually saved the war in the Pacific for the United States. All right, and to finish up, and so on December 8, 1941, President Roosevelt addresses the Senate under Congress, gives his famous infamy speech that this is a day that will live in infamy. And after that, and less than an hour after this speech, how effective President Franklin Roosevelt was. Less than an hour, Congress passed a formal declaration of war against Japan, and the United States officially entered World War II. And Germany and Italy declared war on the United States. 3 days later, the United States subsequently declared war on the Axis powers, starting World War II. All right, cool. So that's the end of the lesson. I'd like to thank Nicole, Kira, and Gabby again for being so kind, and we're all good.